2022 is in the rearview mirror. Thank God. It's been a rough year. I'm going to go through with you today a lot of what's happened in the stock market, what's happened in the bond market. We're going to talk a little bit more about interest rates, the Federal Reserve, and what we think is coming for 2023. Stick around for the monthly economic update. Hello, everybody. I'm Dean Barber, founder and CEO of Barber Financial Group. Welcome to the monthly economic update. This will be more of an annual economic update as we say goodbye to 2022. Good riddance. And hello to 2023. I am actually recording this on the 30th of December, 2022. So it's been a wild ride this year across the board. Inflation, bonds, interest rates, the stock market. They've all been in the headlines. If you've been keeping touch with me all year long, you know that we've been talking about the inverted yield curve. We've been talking about the possibility of a recession in 2023. So let's just step back for a minute and do a quick review of what happened in the month of December and then what happened for the full year. From the Dow Jones Industrial Average to the NASDAQ, from a year-to-date basis, that is the best performing sector was the Dow Jones Industrial Average, losing 8.6%. As we scroll on down here, we see the S&P 500 down 19.27. We see the NASDAQ composite down 33.03%, and then kind of everything in between. I've also been talking to you about these power gauge ratings. We now have three of the major indices that are clearly bearish, the Russell 2000, S&P 100, and the NASDAQ. Those also happen to be the worst performing indices of the year. Everything else is in neutral territory today, with only the Dow Jones Industrial Average being bullish. So as you can see here, in the S&P 500, for an example, there are 118 stocks that are still considered bullish in the S&P 500, while 108 are bearish, 271 are neutral. On the NASDAQ, only 19 are bullish, 22 are bearish, and 59 are neutral. So you can pause this and kind of take a look and see where each one of these are. Suffice it to say, the month of December was not necessarily a very nice month to us. I ended the November monthly economic update by questioning whether or not we would see a Santa Claus rally. The Santa Claus rally did not ensue, and 2023 looks to bring some more difficulties, but it also looks to bring some opportunities. I want to share a couple of new charts with you here today. And this first chart here is showing us money flows out of equity mutual funds. And so here we are in December of 2022. We have seen more outflows of equity mutual funds this year than we've seen since the October 2020 timeframe. December of 2018 was actually the biggest outflow that we've seen in a long, long time. And even October of 2008, as Lehman Brothers collapsed and the financial crisis really began to become a reality. And so here we are with money flows going out of equity mutual funds at the same rate that they did in October of 2020 and October of 2008. So the question becomes, how does the market typically react after we've had that much money flowing out? Here's a chart that shows the 3-month, 6-month, 12-month, and 24-month returns following 1031 of 08. So in the 3 months following, you still had another 14% drawdown, 6 months following 8% loss. But within 12 months, you were 9.8% higher, and within 24 months, you were 27.9% higher. After December 31st of 2018, within 3 months, you were up by 15, 6 months 19, 12 months 31, and 24 months 54%. After the 2020 money flow going out, you were 12.6% higher over the course of the first 3 months, 27% higher 6 months, and 12 months later, you were 41% higher. 24 months, you're only 20% higher, and that's because 2022 comes in there and you had the losses in 2022. But on average, when we see the massive outflows that we've seen, within 3 months, the markets are up 4.5, 12.9 over 6. And 12 months, and this is really where I want to focus, the 12 and 24 months. So what we know is that every bear market is followed by a bull market. The markets tend to overreact. They'll overcorrect to the downside, and then they'll get overpriced on the upside. I don't know yet whether we have overcorrected to the downside. My real impression is that we probably still have a little bit of drawdown to go. I talked to you in 2022 about the Federal Reserve, and when they feel like they've got the inflation under control, that will spur then what I believe will be the next market rally. And as that market rally comes on, I would anticipate some very positive returns in the 12 and 24 month period following that comment from the Federal Reserve that he does have things under control. We've also seen a little bit of reprieve in our bond sector. So here are the AGG, which is the bond aggregate. At worst case scenario, on October 24th this year, the bond aggregate was down 16.6%. As we end the year, it's down 12.6%. These are the biggest losses that we've seen in bonds in my 35-year career. One of the things that we know about bonds is that losses are temporary, unless you bought the bonds at a premium. If you bought the bonds at par, they're going to mature at par. You're going to get the interest rate in between now and then. And something even more frightening is when you look at the 3-year chart on bonds and the 5-year chart on bonds, you know, you're basically flat over a 5-year period. So bonds have made our life more difficult in keeping your money safe and secure, because typically the bonds will increase in value when the stock market's doing poorly. But with inflation and with the Fed being forced to raise interest rate, it has put pressure on bonds. But I do believe that we will see, you know, typically we see a bad year in bonds, we will see some good years follow in bonds. So with all that said, I believe that 2023 is going to be beginning with more volatility. I think the Fed is going to have to continue to raise rates a bit, but I think by the end of the second quarter, the Fed should be finished with its rate hiking cycle. I believe that will also be the point when the economy will potentially be headed into a recession. But remember, the stock market's a leading indicator, and if the economy is slowing enough, then that's going to signal that the Fed doesn't have to raise rates anymore. And in fact, we may see rates start to come down towards the end of the year. That would be a good catalyst for a long-term run in the equity markets and a good catalyst for a good recovery in the bond market. With that, I want to thank you for joining me for the monthly economic update and the year in review here. Hope everybody had a happy and safe new year, and I wish all of you a very prosperous 2023. One more thing before I go, make sure and check out our all-new 2023 retirement planning calendar with all of the important dates that you need to be aware of. Thanks for watching, and make sure that you give us a thumbs up on YouTube and share this with your friends. Also, make sure to subscribe.